What's up?
Mile Higher Homies.
What is up, homies?
How's
we are
it
back.
Hanging?
It is episode 7 today.
7 already.
And we is talking about something really interesting.
What are you doing?
Super interesting today.
Yeah, it is a super, super interesting case. And it's actually something that it was actually one of my first videos that I ever did. I think it was my first crime video, if I'm not mistaken. And it's not just crime, it's conspiracy. There's some paranormal elements. So this is a very, very interesting story. So buckle up, get comfy, get some snacks.
What is it? You didn't even say what it was.
It's the case of Alyssa Lamb. I almost said Alyssa because my best friend's name Alyssa.
Yeah.
She spells it that way.
But. And I mean, at this point, it's not even just a case. It's the mysterious disappearance.
Yeah. Well, she didn't disappear. They found her.
Right.
But she disappeared for a while.
The way she
yeah.
disappeared, yeah, is bizarre.
Yeah.
Tons of crazy elements to this. So get ready, you guys.
Yes.
It's going to be crazy.
Yes, it is. But before we get started, we did want to talk about something really cool that we are trying out today. Today, Josh and I both just took 2 capsules of Cloud9 Brain Booster, which is a CBD product. So it comes from the hemp plant, marijuana plant, but the hemp side of things. And sorry, Josh, why don't you explain it? I'm not good with that.
No, you've got it spot on. No, okay. we just took 2 brain booster capsules.
Mm-hmm.
It's just basically a CBD capsule. So it
so
should
interesting. It
mellow us out a little bit, I think.
Well, it actually just, it's supposed to support your mind, memory, focus,
stimulate.
And brain clarity. It's actually like about mood, memory, motivation, energy, focus, learning, mental clarity, and cognitive ability. So this is a completely natural product. It's completely legal in all 50 states. Buylegalmeds.com.
Yes.
Use
and
the
we
code.
Have a link in the description.
Yes. And there's a code, Kendall Ray, for free shipping.
Yes.
But you guys will have to see if we seem extra focused because we all know how I am. I
yeah.
mean,
hopefully
it's not
we're
Josh,
more focused
me.
This week than last week. We were a little out of it last week, I feel like. But today we're wide awake and ready for this shit. So.
Yes. Okay.
So
let's get right
also,
into it. Oh,
also, yes, we got more.
Oh, there's more. Hang on.
Not yet. Slow down over there.
All
slow
right.
your horses over there. I'm getting too excited. But firstly, just real quick, just wanted to mention the Patreon. Thank you to all those who've become patrons in the past like 2 weeks. We've got like a bunch of people
yeah.
are now patrons. So that's awesome. Thank you guys for doing that. We really appreciate it. Big shout out to our stellar patrons, Elizabeth B, Stephanie S, Michelle C, Chase C, Jake C, and Jim W. Thank you guys so much for being stellar patrons. Also, thanks to all of those out there that went on iTunes and left a review and rating for us. Guys, this really helps us out a lot. Please, if you haven't left a rating or review on any of the platforms, whether it's iTunes, Google Play, whatever it may be, please do that. It helps our podcast get out there and we want to spread the Mile Higher message to the masses. So definitely do that whenever you get a chance.
Mm-hmm.
And lastly, one of the perks of being a patron is that you have access to an exclusive Discord server where you can ask us a question and we may pick it for a quick feature question at the beginning of each episode. And Randy C left us this question for this week. And this has to do with our
Ooh.
Last week's episode.
I
it's very interesting. And his question is, what if JFK had backed down even in the slightest? Do you think he'd still be alive today or was he destined for assassination? That's a great question because I don't know if I have a great answer for it because.
I mean, it's hard to say because we don't really know why JFK was assassinated. If it was a conspiracy, it could have been because he knew something about aliens or he was you
or
know trying
just,
to decentralize everything, trying to shut down federal
get rid of
banking.
All the secrecy in the government. I mean, it seemed like JFK wanted to sort of break the government down.
Yeah.
You know, give a lot more transparency with, you know,
yeah.
the different departments and stuff. So I think that could have been, you know, if there is this conspiracy to assassinate him, then most definitely. I think if he probably just played it cool, you know,
yeah.
he may have made it out alive, but the Kennedy curse though, you know,
mm-hmm.
like that
yeah.
maybe it's just like
destined.
Their family is fucking cursed and
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
He was just destined to go out that way.
Yeah. But I think I will say that I think if at any point anyone did talk to him, some type of, I mean, I wouldn't know who would talk to you about something like this, but if someone did tell him like, hey, dude, like ramp it down. You can't be saying that shit. You can't be trying to free the people. You're not actually working for the people. You're working for us. If someone said that to him, I mean, my guess is that they probably did. Because why, like, assassinating someone is like such a hard thing to do. And then you have conspiracy theorists on you. And it's like, why would you want to do that? I'm sure they tried. So I don't think he was willing to back down.
Yeah.
I think he kept pushing it.
I completely agree with you, actually. I think that, you know, I think that from all the evidence that we investigated last week in our episode on JFK, I just really think that there was, you know, there's some underlying conspiracy for him to be assassinated. I really do. There's just too much evidence. There's too much funky things with that, you know, with that event. And it makes sense. I mean, it honestly makes sense that he got assassinated, as sad as that is.
Yeah. You know?
So
it makes total sense to me.
So yeah, I'm going to go with the answer of, you know, if he had backed down and kept his mouth shut and, you know, just kept the status quo and, you know, kind of kept things rolling and didn't speak out on all these different things that he did, I think there's a great chance that he could have been alive today. So,
yeah.
Crazy, though.
I think it's such a shame that he's not more celebrated in this country either. Like, there's not a lot of celebration surrounding him. And I think it's really sad because he was really such a fighter for the people. He literally died for the cause.
He's almost like MLK in a lot of ways. Oh, and they have a lot of similarities, I think. And
totally.
Especially, I mean, it's clearly the fact that they both were assassinated pretty much. So,
yeah.
You know.
So it's sad that
makes you wonder because, I mean, we really haven't had a president like him.
No.
Since then. Close. I mean, you know, Obama came in preaching all this change and everything and, you know, status quo kind of kept going. So, you know, it makes you wonder. But we won't go any further in that. If you haven't listened to our podcast episode about JFK, please do. It's very interesting.
It is. But thank you, Randy C. That was actually a really great question to start off things. So basically, if you are a Patreon or a patron, sorry, you can ask us a question on this on the Discord chat about Elisa Lam. If you have any questions after this podcast, then we can address it in our next podcast. So it's actually a really cool idea.
Right. And for those that don't know, some of the other rewards for being a patron include early access to the podcast every week. You get to listen to it 24 hours in advance from everybody else, which is pretty cool. Also, Kendall and I put up a video every month early for you guys. And there's some other stuff on there as well. So go check it out. It's patreon.com/milehigher. But I'll stop jabbering and let's dive into this crazy, crazy case of Elisa Lam.
Up. This one's a crazy one.
Oh, and our lava lamp's working today, guys.
Oh, check it out.
sort of working.
It's trying. It's been on for hours, too.
Yeah, it's weird.
I think it's defective.
I think it is, too, but whatever. Yeah. It's cheap. It's a cheap lava lamp.
Okay.
All right. Get ready.
I am ready.
Jump in.
Okay. So, first of all, Elisa Lam, if you do watch my video on it, it is only 12 minutes long. It was my first crime video and it was a fucking mess. I actually just watched it just to see if I had missed anything when researching this again. And I was like, wow, I suck. Like, I was not good at this. I've gotten a lot better since then. So yeah, this is going to be, there's probably going to be a lot of things in this that I didn't talk about or didn't explain well in that video. So don't feel like you've already heard the topic because there's so much more to it. My video was so, so basic. But anyway, so, Elisa Lam was a 21-year-old Canadian student at the University of British Columbia in Vancouver. She set out on a solo trip around the west coast of the United States on January 26th of 2013. Her intention was to visit San Diego and then work her way up through Los Angeles, Santa Cruz, and finally San Francisco. She wrote exclusively about her plans on social media sites such as Tumblr and Facebook, as well as her own blog. Elisa traveled alone, using trains and buses to move from one direction to the next.
During one direction to the next.
Is that?
No, I just thought it was funny. You said literally one direction.
one direction. Sorry, one destination to the next. I got 1D on the brain. Okay, I was watching Harry Styles videos today. I think I just called him Harry Style.
Harry Style.
Harry Styles, sorry. During the first leg of her West Coast tour, as she liked to call it, Lam regularly contacted friends and family, as well as posting pictures online of herself in various locations, such as the San Diego Zoo. So she was taking selfies, posting them on social media, talking to people. Nothing seemed super odd.
Which, yeah, totally normal for a girl of her age. And so eventually she arrived in Los Angeles on January 26th. And at this time, she checked into the Cecil Hotel, which at the time is a modest budget hotel. It's located actually just a few blocks away from the infamous repressed area called Skid Row in Los Angeles. And Elisa Lam was originally supposed to share a room with others, but was moved to her own room when her roommates complained of her certain odd behavior. So this is interesting to me that it seems like even before, you know, she kind of got settled into the hotel, she was starting to kind of exhibit signs of, you know, odd behavior. So kind of interesting.
Okay, so she was 21 years old. Actually, that is very interesting. I just thought of this, but certain types of schizophrenia, or maybe most types of, or all schizophrenia cases. No, that can't be right. But anyway, it's really common for schizophrenia symptoms to start in like your early 20s. So it's possible she was experiencing that. And it's a lot of time people who have never had anything, and then all of a sudden it starts to happen to them. And they're like, am I crazy? Do I tell, like, people don't tell people. There's been cases of people that get that in college and they just like run away. They leave the campus because they're like, they're confused. They get lost. So there's actually quite a bit of examples of that happening. I think that's kind of interesting to know. If she was having odd behavior, maybe it was something related to a mental illness.
Yeah, we'll jump into that more too, but most definitely, I mean, the fact she's, her friends specifically note that she's acting oddly.
Yeah.
Is very interesting. So literally she checked in on the 26th, and then by January 31st, she straight up just fucking disappears, like just gone. And all of her social media posts stopped all of a sudden, and as well as her daily correspondence with her parents. That ended completely as well. She was very close with her parents and kept in touch with them. So the fact that that just ceased all of a sudden is very odd. And so a search for Elisa is organized, and her parents actually flew out to Los Angeles to help with the search efforts. And of course, her disappearance would be reported in the news. And yet there's no evidence that's found, and no one is sure of what happened to her. And the police were called, and they did an entire search of the hotel from top to bottom, as well as the roof. And I mean, they combed this place over. They went into all the places that they possibly could. And they actually even used dogs to help try to find her, but they were unable to pick up any trail of Elisa, and nothing was found after their search. It seemed like literally she had just stepped off the face of the planet. Like, she's just gone, like, without a trace, just completely no idea where she is. And they only came up with a few minor clues from the search and interviews with the hotel staff. And according to the hotel staff, they reported that Lam had been alone that day, but seemingly in good spirits, and she visited a nearby bookstore, and the bookstore employee claims that Lam came in shopping there and that she had been lively and very friendly. And so clearly it seemed like there was nothing out of the ordinary going on with her. She seemed like just, you know, her normal happy self. And other than those few leads that they were able to gather, there's literally nothing else.
That's like the worst type of case too. And it's just like, there's not even a trace of anything.
That's the worst. And I mean, that's probably the hardest case for police too. Cause when, you know, you have nothing to go off of, you're literally stuck, you know, you're at a dead end. And I mean, what can you do really besides like start asking people, did you see her? Did you see her?
Yeah.
And like putting posters up and stuff. Like, that's basically all you can do. So
that's why traveling alone as a 21-year-old woman is really hard. I know some people do it, but it's like you have to be so like vigilant and checking in with people, and You know, yeah. it's easy for something to happen to people when they're alone.
Yeah.
Especially women.
Yeah, exactly.
So because of the lack of evidence that was found, law enforcement was desperate for more clues and information and began posting flyers around the area, imploring people to come forward with the missing woman's whereabouts. At this time, the Cecil Hotel brought forward what would be the first bizarre piece of the puzzle and one of the weirdest unsolved deaths in recent memory. And dude, it's weird. In the form of an odd, creepy piece of elevator surveillance footage, which seems to be the last time anyone saw Elisa alive. And this footage is so weird. Are we going to dub it in?
Yeah, we'll dub it in for you guys okay. So you guys can watch it. We're going to watch it on our computers and we'll comment and try to explain exactly what's going on, what we're seeing, so that you guys that are listening out there can have an idea of, you know, if you haven't seen this elevator footage, you can hopefully have an idea of what is contained within this surveillance footage. So I'll go ahead and play it here and we'll try to explain what's going on here. It's pretty bizarre. So the elevator footage is, of course, kind of grainy and
brightness.
Yeah. So Elisa looks like grainy. She hops in.
She kind of crouches down.
I guess it's an old hotel.
Starts pressing buttons
so.
At the top, but right, so different numbers. She starts pressing all the numbers and then presses close and gets in. And she just waits.
Stands there.
And now what's weird is the elevator door is not shutting. There's no one blocking it. So she's like, why isn't the door shutting? But then that is weird.
That's
so then
weird.
She jumps forward, lurches forward into the hallway, looks both directions as if she's like making sure someone's not chasing her, following her, is coming after her. And then she quickly hops back inside and the door still remains completely open.
Right. So that's odd in itself. One thing I wanted to mention real quick is describe what she's wearing. So looks like she's wearing like black men's gym shorts. I mean, they could be women's shorts, but they look kind of big for women's shorts. I feel like they're kind of long. They go like down to her knees.
I thought it was a skirt. Maybe.
No, that's what people thought, but it's actually gym shorts. Which is interesting. Yeah, they're black gym shorts. She's got a red hoodie and gray t-shirt on. Yeah. When I was researching this, I was like, whoa. Because there is this misconception is that she's wearing a skirt.
Yeah.
But if you look.
That's what I thought.
If you look, it clearly is gym shorts. Like.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's clearly
totally
shorts.
Gym shorts. Look
and
at
like some flip-flops.
And flip-flops.
What's weird to me is she comes in not panicked.
Right.
And then if you were trying to get away from someone, why would you press all the buttons? And then what's also weird or important to know is I think it's possible that the elevator got jammed or stuck or had a malfunction because she pressed all of
right.
the buttons.
Yeah, that's possible.
Okay. So anyway, so
pokes
she's
her head
pressing,
out.
Now she's hiding. So then she comes into the corner of the elevator away from the door. And is hiding, almost like she's waiting to jump out and scare someone. Then she looks out again, cautiously, looks out into the hallway to the right. And she looks like she's just looking for something, looking for someone. She stands there, still standing there.
Steps halfway out, looks the other way. She's like looking down the hallway.
And then she jumps out like all of a sudden, like in 2 feet, and then puts her feet out, puts her feet together, steps back in, almost like foxtrot steps.
Weird.
She starts doing these weird things.
She's just in the hallway right now, just standing
outside
the elevator.
Elevator door still wide open, no sign of shutting.
She like puts her arms up over her head.
Yeah.
She's just standing there. She's kind of out of the view of the camera. What are you doing, dude? And just standing there. And how come the elevator doors aren't shutting?
So then she puts her hands were over her head, almost like she was like waiting for police to arrest her or something. Like it was like a hands up type position. And she goes back in, presses all of the buttons this time.
Or it almost looks like she's pressing certain ones, honestly.
In a pattern. But I think she's pretty much got them all. Look, she's like has all of them lit up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then she steps out again.
Maybe she was like trying to get the elevator to work. That's why she was like fucking with the buttons.
But look at her.
And then
hands
she starts
now.
Doing this weird thing with her hand.
Yeah.
She opens her palms, opens up all her fingers, spread them out, and then does this weird like ravey type
hand
motions
gestures
all
yeah.
around the hotel. I mean, sorry, all around the air in front of her. But it looks like she's almost playing with something. Like she has a imaginary Rubik's cube or something. She's like kind of squatting down. There's still no one there. Elevator door is still wide open. And then she goes back to standing there. puts her hands over her head again.
And then disappears out of view of the camera. And it's just footage of an empty elevator and she's out in the hallway. But wait,
the elevator, I don't know how long it takes, but eventually it shuts after she's gone, which is so weird.
She just like leaves the elevator.
So she's gone. It's just straight up elevator. I don't know at what point.
It's just open.
Oh, okay. So watch. And then it finally shuts like a minute after she left. That's what's so weird is like.
What the hell?
And then it's, I think, slams open again.
What the hell? Bizarre. What is going on?
Sorry, guys. It's hard to like talk about a visual on a podcast, but.
And then the door opens again and no one's there.
So no one pressed the button unless she pressed it. And then I don't know.
But there's no sign of her. And then again. It just shuts again. Like quickly, though, before it stayed open for so long. And the buttons still look like they're kind of pushed in.
They're all lit up still.
I don't know, man. This looks so bizarre, though, because I don't know. Doesn't this look kind of like ghostly a little bit? Like what?
Yeah, then it opens again. No one's there again. Oh, it's on a different floor now.
Now it's on a different floor. So it went down. Yeah, because one of the buttons.
Oh, yeah. She went down one floor.
It went down one floor. But she's not on.
She's not in it. Okay. Okay.
Wow.
So sorry for those that are listening. I'm sure that's not the funnest to listen to a video in your car or something or wherever you are. But hopefully we gave a good commentary.
So yeah, this footage is literally the last time anything or anyone saw her alive as far as we know.
Yeah.
That was it. That was like the last known footage of her before she disappeared.
And if she hadn't have done all that weird shit with her hands and pressed all the buttons and there was like the creepy element of it not shutting, I would think it was just her hiding from someone in the hotel. I mean, she has men's shorts on. So it's kind of like maybe she was with a man and put his shorts on and left.
But that's why.
But then when she starts tripping like that,
that
doing changes
the little
everything.
Doing the little hand things, you start like, yeah, you tripping on something, man. Like
it looked like she was like on weird. Like acid or something.
Looks a little crazy. And so this video footage went viral, obviously, because it's very strange. It's honestly a little spooky.
It's very spooky.
And it is almost horror-like. It's almost like, you know, something you would see out of a horror. Because just her facial expressions, the fact that she hops out, kind of looks scared, then hides in the corner, and then gets out and does these weird hand gestures. It's very, very bizarre. And seriously, though, why didn't the elevator doors close the whole time? Like, after she'd gotten in, and like, usually when you hop into an elevator and press one of the buttons, it shuts, like, within a few seconds. She pressed multiple buttons, which shouldn't affect whether or not the elevator doors close or not. And it stayed open for so long. And then after she got off, it decides to close. That's pretty weird.
Yeah.
That's really fucking weird.
I know. Like,
that doesn't make any sense whatsoever. I know.
She was standing there quite a while with it open too.
Yeah.
And for it to finally close after and then start moving.
Yeah.
And it clearly was fine. It started going down.
No,
like
I know.
Normal.
Then it went normal after she had probably
it's almost
left
like
the area.
The elevator was like possessed to not move or to not let her get off that floor.
Yeah.
So
like
weird.
She was trapped on that
Imagine
floor
if something. She had tried to like take the stairs instead. She'd probably be fine.
The only thing that I can think of possibly, and I have no idea because I don't know elevators. I'm not an elevator guy, but maybe the way that she pressed those buttons or something, or the order or pattern or something, maybe these elevators have like a disable feature or something. Like if they're pressed too many times, or like maybe it like just causes it to like stop for a while.
That's why I said
like
earlier.
Stop for a few minutes. You did? Oh, okay.
But yeah, no, it's okay. I just was saying, yeah. Yeah, it's just like how it started randomly after a while though.
No, that's what I'm saying is like maybe it does like a minute. You know how like other devices and stuff, if you press a bunch of buttons like your computer or something, it kind of locks up for like a minute. And you have to just wait for it to kind of unlock itself before you can start using it again.
Okay,
you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So maybe the way she pressed the buttons or the pattern she pressed it in is like some sort of like disable feature or lock feature.
But wouldn't the hotel say that though? The reason, like why didn't the hotel say, well, the reason the elevator stopped is because we have it set up for this, whatever.
You can't tell from the video. How would they know? The video footage is too grainy to really see what buttons she pushed.
You could easily see what buttons she pushed. They're lit up. I could see them.
No, but what exact? Like, I'm saying that maybe you do 1, 2, B, parking garage. Like, there's a certain code to it. why there could be. That's what I'm saying. Or maybe she pressed
a code for a minute delay.
I don't know. Maybe you never know. Like maybe they would. That's what I'm saying.
I could see a code for completely stopping it. But I don't know. I mean, what do I know? I'm not a fucking
yeah. Well, I don't know. Maybe expert. There's like a certain code that like the elevator technicians press
yeah,
to like disable it temporarily or something. I don't know. It's just right. a thought. Okay. Just a thought. Just a thought.
Okay. So due to her mysterious disappearance, a lot of theories have made the rounds.
Yes.
Obviously. Because when there's an unsolved anything, the
theories
internet
pop up.
Detectives get to work like me. One theory was that she was trying to escape from some unseen pursuer, whether real or not. Okay, I'm not even gonna, I don't do well reading stuff. That's the first theory, is that there was someone trying to come after her.
Yeah. And whether, and at this point, we don't know if this is a physical person. We don't know if this is some sort of supernatural force that's after her. I mean, we have no idea, but it would explain the weird evasive behavior and watching her hide. Like, why would you only hide when you feel like you're being chased by something.
Right.
So that would, you know, if somebody was chasing her or she felt like she's being chased by maybe some invisible force or something.
Yeah. Well, her the hand motions make it so weird. But I mean, if I didn't see the weird hand motions, I would have just thought, I mean, there's a lot of rapes that happen in hotels. It's like very, very common because it's hotel. It's like easy, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, I was thinking it's possible. I mean, maybe someone drugged her though.
Right. It could have been.
I mean, that was a side effect of the drug, like GHB.
Or
is that
ecstasy.
What it's, is it GHB? Is the date rape drug?
Well, some GHB. People have speculated that she could have been on ecstasy even.
GHB drug.
And that. I don't know. Maybe that's something to do with the fact that she was suffering from yeah. depression.
Club drug or date rape drug. Yeah. That she was what?
That she could have been using ecstasy. She could have been on ecstasy possibly. Cause then when you're on ecstasy, you typically could do, you know, want to like do weird things with your hands.
But
and
don't you
like
have
that.
Like quite a bit of control when you're on ecstasy to the, like,
depends though. Depends on the person. Yeah. Typically you do, but she was also on other medications. I mean, there's a lot of things that could play into this. She suffered from depression and bipolar personality disorder. And so maybe she was having some kind, and you know, maybe it wasn't drugs and maybe she was just having a psychotic episode or something.
Or like she was drugged and because she has, maybe she had developing schizophrenia or some type of other mental illness and being drugged makes it worse. That's a possibility too. I mean, as long as we're talking about this theory right now of it being someone else.
Yeah, no, it's very possible.
Okay, should we go through?
Yeah. Do you know where you're at?
Yes. No. Oh yeah, we talked about this. Okay. A few weeks after Lamb's strange disappearance, hotel residents began to complain of lower water pressure and strange tasting discolored water. This is fucking disgusting. So there was time people would turn on their faucets and it was black water
for like a few seconds. Yeah.
Yeah. And then it would run clear. But what? So, okay. So I guess we haven't even explained what happened.
We're getting there.
So why does this?
So yeah. Okay. So the water pressure was low and on February 19th, 2013, so this is a few weeks later after she disappeared. That's what's crazy about this is that she's been gone for a few weeks.
Okay. So people had already seen the footage, right? When she was still not found. So people were running with all these theories
right, exactly.
before they found her.
That's why we just talked about the footage.
So the worker, some hotel worker, I think it was like a custodian or something, was sent to go check on the water tank since so many guests were calling down like, yo, my water is black.
Tastes nasty as fuck.
Yeah. So these water tanks are suspended 10 feet over a heavily secured area with alarm systems in place.
Which is what you would expect. I mean, it's on the roof.
Yeah.
And usually you can't get roof access to a hotel. It's usually locked doors or security systems.
Because people can jump off.
Right.
People can do crimes up there.
So it makes sense that no one would have access to this area.
If you've seen How to Get Away with Murder, there's a water tank murder in that.
Oh, yeah.
But Anyway, one of the water tanks was opened. I'm surprised no one had even gone up there. What the hell?
They did. The police went up there.
But why was the tank open then?
No, they opened the tank. It was closed. The tank was closed. It wasn't open when it was found, when it they says, went up there.
It says, when the water tanks were opened.
When
oh,
one of the, yeah.
I'm sorry. This is why it's hard to have me read things. I don't even read things in my videos because I'm so dyslexic. It's so hard to read. Okay. So inside of one of the water tanks, they found the waterlogged corpse of Elisa Lam. It was found nearly 3 weeks after she had mysteriously disappeared. So.
Just floating face down in one of these water tanks that people have been drinking out of, that have been showering out of.
3 weeks.
3 weeks. I'm so. You know, like, I'm a little, I mean, I guess it would take, because I was like, well, maybe, you know, why'd it take so long for them to realize the water pressure's bad? You would think that if you had a body floating in a tank, you would, there would be some sign, or maybe the maintenance would check the tanks more often, or like, why was it like weeks at a time?
How about the fact that someone went missing from their hotel and they didn't do a full check? Like, procedure would be to
the tanks.
Do a full check of the whole place. Right,
and check the tanks. On the initial
search.
But the reason why is that these tanks are almost impossible to get to. Like I'll show you later. Like, there's a picture. If you scroll down, we'll put the picture up for you. But like, if you look at these water tanks, it doesn't look like it's easy to get to or easy to open. These are big, really big water tanks, really heavy, solid metal tanks.
Yeah, dude, there's no way I could open that.
And she was just found completely nude, covered in some sand-like substance.
Sand-like substance? Yeah. I didn't even know that part.
With her clothes and belongings bobbing around. Her clothes and belongings were in the tank with her in this nasty, murky water. And she'd been in the tank for a couple weeks just decomposing. So that would explain, you know, until the body starts decomposing, you probably wouldn't necessarily notice a change in the water color or pressure. You know, it would take some time for that to happen. So I guess it kind of makes sense. But again, your point of why the hell, when they did a search of the roof, did they not think, maybe somebody could have hopped in one of these water tanks, or maybe that'd be a place to stash a body.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't look like there's much else going on up on the roof. So the fact that they didn't check it, but the reason why is like this, like, why would anybody be able to get there other than like the maintenance crew?
Yeah.
Because the rooftop was pretty well secured and had a bunch of alarm systems, and none of them had gone off. There was no record of an alarm being tripped or anything on the roof. So that's really odd. And the tank is in a very difficult to reach spot, and there's no ladder at the scene. How the hell did she climb up there?
Dude, oh my God.
There's no ladder. There's no prints.
Maybe that's
nothing.
Why they didn't think to check, because it would be like fucking impossible to get.
It would be nearly impossible to get up
in by
there.
Yourself. But still, someone could have put her in there, so they still should have checked.
They still should have checked.
Notice how these crazy cases normally involve shitty police work.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Yeah. Pretty. Yeah, you're very right. There's so many cases where all this weird shit happens, and the police do an absolutely dismal job at investigating it.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
Because how did Elisa Lam was a fairly small, you know, average size woman. She was 5.5 feet, 120 pounds. So somehow, when she was possibly either drugged or having a psychotic episode, hauled her ass up to the tank, got undressed, and then jumped into the tank with all of her stuff. How does that happen? That doesn't make any sense.
Mm-mm.
It just, how? How do you do this? This is interesting, though. So the Cecil's chief maintenance guy or engineer, Pedro Tovar, noted that there are only four ways to get onto the roof. There's three fire escapes, which you can get to via the interior doors, and one staircase from the 14th floor. However, an alarm will sound if someone attempts to open the door to the roof if it is not deactivated first, something that typically only hotel employees would be able to do. If the alarm sounds, it is audible to the front desk as well as the 14th and 15th floors. Assuming one could get onto the roof undetected, Tovar said that you would first have to climb up to the platform the tank sits on, then squeeze between them and the other plumbing equipment. There, you would need to find another ladder. So it's multiple platforms even get to the tank. You'd have to have another ladder, which you could use to climb onto one of the four tanks. And each of the tank lids is heavy metal, which you'd have to be able to open before you could even get inside. So clearly, this is probably why there's so much speculation and questions about how did she end up in this tank? Because how the hell does a small woman like her somehow manage to climb up on these tanks, open a heavy ass metal lid, open it up enough so she can hop in
and take close her clothes it. Off at some point?
Yeah.
Why would she strip down? And who would?
And then close the heavy ass door to lock herself in to drown. If this was a suicide or accidental drowning, that's how it would have to be done. And again, like you just said, why would you take your clothes off if you were just going to kill yourself, you know, and drown yourself?
Well, and I would like to point out, there's a lot of people that think that she killed herself on purpose. And I think it's very hard to kill yourself by drowning. I think it's actually impossible. I'm pretty sure I've heard that. It's almost impossible to drown yourself.
Well, it's not impossible if you like jump in a tank like this and shut the lid on yourself.
Yeah. If you put up a, but it's impossible to like get underwater and like.
Well, yeah, it's impossible to like just like keep yourself underwater without something forcing you to be underwater. It's very difficult.
It's impossible to kill yourself by holding your breath above whatever.
It'd be, yeah, because you would need some sort of force holding you under because your natural reaction is like to.
Tiredness or something or like.
Yeah, you'd have to be like stranded impaired. In sea or something or.
Yeah.
On major drugs.
It's just, I'm just noting it's a weird way to commit suicide.
Right. Out of all the, like,
you could drug yourself or, you know.
If this is what she wanted to do, would commit suicide, why not just jump off of the roof?
Yeah, totally.
Why not go onto the roof and then just jump off and then call it good? And, you know, if it's really suicide.
Yeah, it seems very, that's why I just don't believe the suicide theory because it's just so odd. That's the weirdest way I would have ever heard. I don't know.
Yeah, it's extremely weird. And so the police, they find the body in the tanks. And again, they go back to the elevator footage and they begin to scrutinize it further. And from the video footage, like we explained earlier, it just shows a frustrated young woman trying to get to the elevator to work, exiting it, re-entering it. And doing the weird hand gestures, that's really weird. I mean, to me, that signifies either drugs or, you know, just a psychotic episode or something. And, or maybe she was just trying to do it to try to get the elevator sensors to work. You know, maybe she was just trying to like get the doors to close with those weird hand gestures, like trying to wave at it.
Well, I would get that if you were doing it in front of the door, but she was completely out in the hallway doing it in a different direction, so.
But the fact that she clearly looks like she's trying to hide from somebody, and it does actually look like at one point she may be talking to someone off the screen, like she had gone out of the elevator and like maybe had been talking to somebody. Mm-hmm. And of course, why does the door appear to only work after she has left the elevator, you know, after several minutes of not seeing her on the video? That's very, very bizarre. So,
by the way, I just wanted a quick note because I saw comments about this. If you guys see me yawning a lot, I've been yawning so much since this podcast started. I think it's an anxiety thing for me because not that I have anxiety right now, but I get nervous talking about these cases. I get really into it and I yawn. I don't know. I've like always had that problem. Like, and a yawn is never enough. So just wanted to point that out. Cause I didn't, some people were like, Kendall looks bored. Kendall looks tired. I do have chronic fatigue. So maybe that's why, but I'm not tired. I'm extremely into this. I get like resting bitch face sometimes too on here. Cause like when I think I look like really angry or like someone said I was being mean to you in one of them, I was like, no, so I just get so passionate about this stuff. Oh, look.
Oh, wow.
I am broken out in a full rash right now on my chest. This happens every single time I get passionate about anything. So just wanted to side note. I think you should keep reading because I have like the yawns really bad
okay.
right now.
No worries. No
I'm
worries.
I'm just a struggle bus. I feel like no you worries. Should just read all the time, actually.
Sure thing. it's fine. I'm a good reader. I played that Reader Rabbit as a kid. You remember Reader Rabbit? Sorry, random thought.
Hell yeah. No Reader Rabbit.
Anybody out there play Reader Rabbit?
How about
I don't
Freddy
know
Fish?
Why that just popped into my
Pajama
head.
Pajama Sam. Dude, oh. Freddy Fish was my shit. Because, and you know why? It was a mysteries. It was like solve the mysteries. Pajama Sam.
Or like.
I've always loved this shit.
Wasn't there one called like Carmen? Where's Carmen? Carmen.
Yes. Where in the world is Carmen Where San Diego? Yeah. That was my jam.
That was awesome. That was a great game.
Remember they'd call you Gumshoe?
Gumshoe. Oh, yeah.
Like you're an assistant Gumshoe.
Yes. Oh, man.
Dude, we should get that game out and like try to play it. It was so fun. It was like, where could she be? And you're like taking planes. All right. Sorry, guys. Sometimes I feel like we need to have a little.
Especially
little
when
break.
We're talking about like such a heavy topic like this. Like this is such a.
Makes me upset. I'm so emotional about it. I'm like so hot right now. I just feel I hate unsolved things. I feel so bad for these people, you know?
Yeah, I do too. And she was a very promising young woman and seems like she was struggling with depression. She had ongoing depression and she had other mental health issues, which she often wrote about in her blog. And she actually had a slogan on her blog. That's a quote by author Chuck Palahniuk. And the quote is, "You're always haunted by the idea of wasting your life." Interesting.
Well, I feel like that's such a good quote for her too, because she, I mean, so anyone who's like brave enough and adventurous enough to go on a huge trip at age 21 by themselves, you know, so she was clearly about life experiences and living it up.
Live it up. Yeah. Live it up.
So that's travel. Also why the suicide theory is weird.
Right. Well, that's exactly what we're talking about is she had these ongoing issues like mental health issues, but who doesn't have mental health issues? I mean, we all have
me
you know our
just
issues.
Got back from the psychiatrist
looking at you over there. No, I have mental issues of just being too deep sometimes.
Mental issues of being too deep. Okay. Yeah, but I mean, yes, it's hard to be a human.
But Alisa had been taking several different medications for her bipolar disorder and her ongoing depression. Mm-hmm. And those included Wellbutrin and Lamictal, actually.
Ooh.
I don't know if you've used or been prescribed Wellbutrin.
On Wellbutrin for 4 years.
Can
I
you
just
comment
found out
to that?
Today it's like targeted, it's for depression and I need it for anxiety. And the doctor literally has been giving me the wrong medication for 3 years, people. That's what's wrong with our healthcare system. They just prescribed this. I've been waiting for it to work for 3 years, and I just found out it doesn't even help anxiety. But yes, I've been on Wellbutrin. It's a pretty strong drug. I've been on it for straight up 3 years.
What are the? Have you had any side effects from it?
4 years now. Damn. I don't know, because I can't even tell if I thought it was helping me. I thought I'd be way worse
so
right now
if I wasn't
on it. So it's
supposed to make you more just like positive? Like, I don't know. I've never had depression.
Well, it targets clinical depression, which is not always, you know, people are often confused about depression because they think it's like something where something happened to you and you're sad because someone died, or you're sad because you don't think you're good enough, or it's not always the case. Like sometimes it's completely just chemicals in your brain. That's what it was for me when I first got on this medication 4 years ago.
So is it like just kind of like a mood booster? Or is it just totally doing like chemical stuff in your brain to help kind of like level out your like dopamine and all your different levels?
She was just explaining it to me. I'm so bad. I know it doesn't have serotonin in it.
So it's not a serotonin booster?
Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, we're not doctors, so it's really hard to talk. But Lamictal, actually, I can talk about Lamictal. I just realized my sister was on Lamictal for seizures.
Yeah.
When we thought she had epilepsy. It was something else, but.
Epileptic
Dude, that's
medication.
That's a strong fucking drug. That was really hard for my sister to be on, I remember.
Which they use it to treat bipolar disorder as well.
Yes.
I find it odd. Like, I don't understand how these medications, they like develop these medications for a particular type of issue. So, Wellbutrin for depression, Lamictal for anti-epileptic. But somehow it's also good for other things. Like, that doesn't make sense to me. Like, how does that work exactly? Do you, I mean, I'm not expecting you to know the answer.
No, I do know how it works, actually. I was just at a psychiatry appointment. So great. I just learned about all this for the first time.
I have no idea, because I've never been on a regular prescription medication ever.
Oh,
I've
my God, you're so lucky.
No, I know.
I'm on so many things.
Like, I use Advil, like, once a month and I'm good. Like, I don't use any medications at all.
That's the thing, is I'm on so many, I don't know what the side effects are anymore, and I don't know what is a side effect and what is just how I am.
Right.
But what was the other one you were just asking about?
No, I was asking about how they develop a medication for, so like Lamictal, they develop it for epilepsy, but then it's also somehow good for bipolar disorder.
Yeah, it's the same with Vyvanse. It's a medication for ADHD, but it's also it's used for binge eating patients. And
it just Prozac, seems like two just, sides of like the spectrum. Like, what's going on? That, how does that help?
Yeah, I don't know. And it's something, I don't know. I think it's because it's changing your brain.
It must be the brain
chemistry. It has effects of it.
Yeah.
You know, so like Prozac also is used to treat bulimia.
Yeah. So, yeah. Huh.
Yeah, there's all kinds of drugs that are used in multiple different ways. But anyway, those aren't like extremely out of the ordinary, I guess.
No, it's pretty, I mean, it's not like, you know, it's not like she was on like schizophrenia medication or something. I mean, I don't even know what medication you'd use for that, but
I don't either.
But as far as we know, it seems like Elisa had been coping well for the most part, and at one point she claims that she had had a relapse, but we don't really know exactly what that relapse is or what she's talking about when she said that. And this is coming from her blog, and her blog also offers other clues to her mental condition. Her tone does seem to fluctuate wildly from happy and outgoing to depressed, sulky, and self-deprecating, depending on the day, and sometimes even within the same post, which is not totally out of the ordinary for somebody with bipolar disorder. So, you know, nothing that really raises, you know, eyebrows there. But apparently she mentions having been raped at one point. And apparently this was maybe something that contributed to her depression. I mean,
oh, completely.
I mean, obviously.
I wouldn't ever say a traumatic name, but I have someone very close to me that has been raped, and it changed like her whole life. Like, she's still struggling years later. So absolutely, that can really change things for you.
So yeah, I mean, that would definitely, I mean, I can't even imagine what that would be like, and you know how you'd feel after that, but I can imagine you would most definitely be very depressed.
Very, yeah.
So you know, the idea or the theory is that, you know, this depression and mental instability had spiraled into a full-blown bipolar disorder and psychosis. And this was the, this is what ended up causing Elisa to kill herself. And she just was in this, you know, fit of rage and just kind of lost her mind. And this is one of the theories.
Yeah.
That, you know, she may have decided to just kill herself, and odd way to kill yourself, but it's possible. We don't know, but it's possible.
I just think that's so, so bizarre.
Because
why not jump? If you want to like drown, jump off a bridge or something. Sorry, it sounds really weird to talk about suicide this way, but it just feels very unlikely to me that she would have chosen that way to do that. Although all of these things does make sense for someone who was struggling with suicidal thoughts. So at the same time, if it was a different way, I would go with this theory a lot more.
The suicide.
If she jumped off or drugged herself or something.
So she obviously had mental health issues. She was battling depression, and her hotel roommates had complained that she was acting strange. But there's not necessarily any red flags or markers that would stand out to indicate that she was suicidal through her blog posts, her contact with her friends and family. So it seems like it would have been very shocking and surprising if she had committed suicide, because her family were like, we would have never saw that coming.
And who on vacation I mean, if you were going to, there are people that go away when they're going to kill themselves. That's actually super common, going to a hotel to do it. But it's not as common to do it like on a huge trip all across California that you've planned. If you're going to do something like that, you go and, you know, right away. You don't like go on a vacation.
Right.
You wouldn't. I mean, you're happy on vacation. You're happy when you're traveling.
Unless she randomly had some sort of psychotic episode, just lost her shit and did a crazy thing and commit suicide. But again, going back, how did she get in the tank? Why, if she got to the roof, why would she just jump off? Why would she choose to like drown herself inside this water tank? How'd she get into it physically? Too many, you know, questions around that to really make me believe that it was, you know, suicide. But it's possible that she may have been under the influence of some sort of drug other than the drugs she was taking for her mental condition. So it's possible. But this theory is literally been debunked because the toxicology reports that turned that they did when they did the autopsy turned up no signs of drugs or alcohol in the system, and she had no history of drug or alcohol abuse to begin with. So that's pretty much X'd right there. So
can drugs like leave your body though after 3 weeks?
I mean,
or like
that's the thing, is like depending on the drug.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know how drugs would, you know, how your body would deal with drugs in your system post-mortem. Like once you're gone,
how does
your body system, I think your body system keeps going for a little bit. Like, you know, it takes a little while for it. So it's possible for, I remember reading about this before, and I think it's at least like a day, 24 hours, maybe four. It's a little while after you're dead that your body, you know, your systems kind of keep going. Like you keep going, you know, even though you're gone. So I think it is possible that she may have had some sort of date rape drug or something along those lines in her system.
Yeah.
And by the time, I mean, she was decomposing in a tank for 3 weeks.
I really think it could have been GHB, because I remember reading somewhere that can leave your system and that after 3 weeks, you may not be able to detect it. I remember listening to a whole guy on a podcast or something talking about this. That was like an expert on this case. So I think there's a good chance of that. And if she was already suffering from other mental issues, or she was just raped, maybe it would cause you to act like that or have a weird reaction with GHB.
Yeah. I mean, it's totally possible. And to make matters even more crazy and almost sinister in a way is that the autopsy report for her body, it took 4 months, and there were tons. So let me back up a little bit. We're going to talk briefly about just how bad the police did at this. And just, it seems like missed things everywhere. The autopsy report took 4 months to complete. And there were tons of delays before the report was finally released.
4 months?
Yeah.
Well, maybe her body was in very odd condition from being in water for 3 weeks.
But what's interesting is that apparently it was originally announced that it would be released the week after her death. Because normally it's pretty quick. Normally it's like pretty quick. But 4 months? Like,
holy shit.
What's going on with that? That's a little odd.
That is very odd.
And this is according to like Elisa's family and other witnesses to this, like hotel staff and other people involved with this case. And they said that the authorities were strangely non-transparent, evasive, and uncooperative with the press. So when reporters are digging into this, they're not getting much out of the authorities, which I guess I'll just come out and say it. The autopsy report, the coroner basically concluded that this was an accidental drowning. There was not signs, according to the coroner, of suicide here. They ruled this, the official ruling of this case is that she just accidentally drowned.
Drowned though? How can they even say that when she was in a water tank? If she was found in a pool, maybe drowning makes sense, but why the hell was she in the tank in the beginning?
That's what they concluded, yeah. It was ruled an accidental drowning.
Well, they probably determined that the cause of death was drowning.
Right. Yes. That's what I'm saying.
They don't know.
They're saying that she was mentally unstable. She.
Oh, that's so interesting, actually, because if they found out that, I didn't even think about this. If they found out that she died of drowning and that was the cause, then it's not like someone killed her and then stashed her body there. And there was no other report of how she died.
That's what's interesting is that how would somebody like kill her and there not be any traces of anything else other than she just drowned?
And naked.
I mean,
and she was hiding in the video.
So I'm sorry. The police concluded that it was a suicide.
Okay.
Due to accidental drowning.
The police.
Yes. So that's what the official police report is, that.
So the coroner said accidental drowning.
The coroner said the cause of death was drowning.
Okay. That makes sense.
That's what they said.
Okay.
But the overall, it was suicide. She was unstable. She lost her shit. Somehow climbed the tank, hopped in the tank, closed it, and drowned herself.
That's the police theory.
That's the official theory going on.
I seriously wish police departments wouldn't have such pressure or feel like they have to come to a conclusion. If it's unsolved and you can't, like, without a doubt say that she killed herself, why are you, like, saying that that's the cause of death? You shouldn't, like, because then people don't look into it further. It should be unsolved. Why isn't that more common? It's like police departments just want to wrap it up,
of course,
put a bow
they do.
On that's, it and be done. Right. No more pressure, no more questions.
That's how, if you're a detective working on this case, the goal is to close that case as fast as possible. Plus, they have tons of other cases they're working on. So the idea is to move through the cases as fast as possible. Basically, there's not enough resources. There's not enough detectives to really spend the time. Like they need like one person that's dedicated to this that is going to explore every option, but they don't do that.
Well, did her family hire a private detective?
I actually don't know that. I know that they brought about a lawsuit against the Cecil Hotel for wrongful death. They're trying to sue the Cecil Hotel.
I'll blame them, dude. I was staying in that hotel, I would have sued the fuck out of them for the water. Ew. Dude, I would rage. Oh my God. I wonder if all the guests had to be notified, like, of everyone who stayed there for the past 3 weeks. Do you think they had to call and, like, say, yo, so this is kind of awkward, but
there was a dead
body in the water tank the whole time you were here, and you were drinking water that was with her body.
Had a decomposing body in it. That's disgusting.
My God, it makes me want to throw up.
But I come back. I mean, it is odd that it took 4 months for them to come up with it was a suicide due to accidental drowning, basically. She killed herself by drowning in this tank. It took 4 months for the authorities to come up with that answer. To me, that seems like something they should have been able to figure out, like, straight off the bat after within a week after discovering her. If that was the, you know, conclusion they were going to come to with this case, why did it take 4 months to figure that out?
Why were they so
you know, sketchy about, you know, about answering questions around her death and just being odd?
I can't even, like, that would make sense if there was some, like, conspiracy angle or, like, someone who would, you know, but that doesn't, like,
but
why would the police cover up? I don't know, this is so confusing. All right.
So now getting to some of the residents that were there that were interviewed. So apparently these residents were on the fourth floor of the Cecil Hotel where Elisa had actually been staying. And they claimed that the police had not once interviewed them while the investigation was taking place. And this seems to be a kind of a trend with investigations, that police aren't interviewing everybody that could have seen something, known something, could have, they just, it's like,
well, maybe they want to, you know, like I said, wrap it up real quick, and like having someone else's input throws them off and
throws a wrench into everything.
Yeah.
So that's why there is a conspiracy around this case, that maybe there's a cover up, going on with the police somehow. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if there's enough evidence to go that far to say that the police somehow were involved with this and then covered it up, but it is very odd that it took this long to figure out the cause of death and everything.
Very odd.
And actually, so this case is so popular and the footage went viral. So obviously all the amateur, you know, web sleuths out there, you know, took a stab at it, and people have analyzed this video, and some have pointed out that the original full video may have been secretly replaced with a shorter version, missing a minute of footage.
Yeah, I did see a lot about this.
Yeah, and that some parts may have been slowed down or changed in some way.
Yeah.
And apparently you can see in the video there's a time jump, which is odd. So that would indicate that the video was altered in some way.
Yeah. And I think people have like sped it up to like the right timing. And that's because like in my video, I had footage of the door closing really quickly. And that was like what people believe is the real footage, that maybe the elevator doors were like slamming and opening, which looks a little more paranormal.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe this was all about like the Cecil Hotel and like bad press for them, because this is a haunted hotel, and maybe they were trying to shake that reputation. They're like, oh fuck, someone else died here. Cause we'll get more into all the weird things that happened there, but
yeah, actually we'll dive in that here in a sec, but I wanted to bring this up too, cause this is really bizarre. Apparently, and I looked everywhere for this, but apparently there's another piece of hotel surveillance footage, which I would assume the police have, so maybe they still possess this, but apparently some people have seen footage that appears to show Elisa entering the building with two men under mysterious circumstances. And I couldn't find it, otherwise I would definitely show you guys, but apparently there is surveillance footage of her entering the hotel with two men, and this is backed up by police detective Tennell. He described the footage, saying, "We did see her come in with two gentlemen. She had, they had a box and gave it to her. And then they went up into..."
She went upstairs into her elevator, right, and we never saw them again. So they gave her a box and then took off.
Yeah.
Ooh, interesting. Maybe they gave her some type of drug. Like she bought something to have like an experience. Like she was like, "I'm here in California. Like there's easier access to certain drugs I want to try." And she like hooked up with these guys and they gave her something in a box.
That's possible. Cause I mean, the only way that this makes sense is that she had some crazy drug.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even know what drug it would be. Cause I mean, maybe
she was all into blogging. I don't know. No.
Or like, maybe it was like salvia or something.
If she did it, I'm sure it was to like have a psychedelic experience. And like, especially when she was doing that with her hands. I don't know. I mean, I guess it's like confusing though, because I guess it could be found in her system, but maybe it wasn't something that's like tested on drugs. Maybe it was something
new. Or
yeah, for those of you who don't know, there's drugs. There's a psychedelic drug in like frog skin venom, certain kind of frog, and people like get it out and smoke this frog venom. Like there's all kinds of drugs that are like natural from plants and stuff. Could be something that they just necessarily didn't test for. Maybe that's why it was in a box.
Absolutely. Could have been some unknown substance that wouldn't show up on a toxicology report even.
Yeah.
So it's it almost seems sort of likely, but why? And why would they escort to the hotel with this? I mean, and two men, it's very bizarre. It just adds to this. it just adds to the, you know, oddness of this case. I mean, it's just bizarre. And what's crazy is that there's also people that believe that there may be some sort of supernatural explanation for this. And before we talk about that specifically, this hotel, the Cecil Hotel, does have a very dark and ominous history. There's a lot of fucked up shit that went down in that hotel. So to give you a brief history of the hotel, it started as a moderately upscale hotel in the 1920s for the business clientele, but then the Great Depression hit. So this is an old ass hotel. And the area around the hotel deteriorated during the 1930s, and it turned into just a cheap accommodation for, you know, sketchy, transient, shady characters, prostitutes, drug dealers, gangsters. Mm-hmm. I mean, who knows?
Yeah. And a really dicey reputation.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So during this time, a couple killers came through the hotel's doors, and One of those was serial killer Richard the Night Stalker Ramirez.
Oh, geez. I don't even know who that is.
Jack Unterweger. And apparently the serial killer Richard Ramirez stayed in a room on the top floor of the hotel in 1985. And at the time, he was very active. He actually ended up killing 13 victims while he stayed at this hotel.
Oh, my God. You could never get away with that today, by the way. At a hotel. I mean, yeah, clearly there's still serial killers that kill people. But in a hotel where there's like cameras and so much technology and all these people to see you. And
yeah,
it'd be pretty hard to be a serial killer in a hotel these days and not leave any evidence in the hotel. I mean, what was this guy doing?
Well, he wasn't. I don't think he was actually killing in the hotel. He was killing outside of it.
Oh, but he was just staying there.
Right. He would come back to the hotel and dump his bloody clothes in the hotel dumpster. And then enter through the back door of the hotel.
Okay. So, well, I was going to say, like, if he was killing people on the hotel, that would explain, like, the haunted
right
aspect.
But definitely bringing bad juju in there for sure.
Oh, yeah.
And then this other guy is this Austrian serial killer, Unterweger. And he went on a murderous rampage across several countries killing prostitutes. And he also stayed at the Cecil Hotel in 1991. And while he was staying there, he killed three prostitutes in the Los Angeles area who he, you know, beat, sexually assaulted, and strangled. The police believe that this guy may have stayed at the Cecil Hotel specifically because the other serial killer, Ramirez, had stayed there. But that's just sort of like, you know, coincidence that those guys were there. But there's also a long history of numerous suicides at the hotel, especially during the 50s and 60s. It was a popular spot for people to end their own lives by jumping from the windows of the upper floors.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this would definitely raise some suspicion and cause for concern of supernatural activity for sure. Multiple people hurled themselves out of windows. There was, multiple suicides there. One person was found dead in their hotel room after being beaten, raped, stabbed, and strangled, and no perperpetrator was ever found in 1964. And this murder remains unsolved to this day. Odd. Interesting. I don't know. That's kind of weird, though. What if there was like a Cecil Hotel serial killer that's like somehow just like randomly chose her as a victim or something? I don't know. That just came to my mind.
Yeah.
But yeah, this hotel has got just a very sinister history.
Oh, real quick before I lose this thought. It's possible that someone like drowned her in a bathtub or somewhere else and then put her in the tank. Because then it would explain like the accidental drowning element of it, how she died. Maybe someone drowned her somewhere else and then...
Right, how do we know she...
I guess the pool would be hard, but like probably in a bathtub.
It's possible for sure.
Yeah.
But... based upon this crazy history of this hotel and just her strange behavior in the elevator, this has people thinking that possibly there is some sort of maybe demonic force or supernatural force in this hotel that could be responsible for the death of Elisa Lam.
Oh, interesting. Another rumor is that the Cecil Hotel was one of the last places where Elizabeth Short was. I just did a video on her, otherwise known as the Black Dahlia. Stayed there before her grisly unsolved murder in 1947. That was the one where her body was like cut up and like found in public, just in a grass lot.
Oh, naked. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a weird one. So maybe she stayed there. She was like, again, cursed.
The fact that she was found naked is weird.
Yeah, she was found naked too. Yeah.
So obviously something happened there. I mean, she could have had a psychotic episode and just like took her clothes off, but I don't know.
Yeah, Elisa.
It's really weird. But as the theories go around this supernatural force that would have basically led to Lam eventually killing herself or being killed or possessed by these evil forces. So maybe that's how she ended up in the tank. And some people claim that if you look hard enough at the elevator footage, you can see a shadow or ghostly form in the video. I actually kind of noticed that myself.
Wow. Did you read this part real fast? That's interesting. This is such bad luck. There's so much bad luck surrounding this place.
Yeah.
Someone named Pauline She was 27 years old. She hurled herself out of the ninth floor window and landed on a nearby passerbyer, George Gianni, 65. She killed him by jumping and landing on him.
Wow.
Wow, that's weird. I've never even heard of that happening. They were both killed instantly. Damn.
So definitely a lot of just bad shit went down at the Cecil Hotel.
Yeah.
God. Wow. Just craziness.
Another murder.
So, yeah. So people think that possibly this hotel is extremely haunted, could even have some sort of, whether it's, you know, supernatural force or demonic force or something evil lurking inside this hotel that could have somehow been responsible for her death.
Hmm.
This is also another theory that exists. And this theory has to do with tuberculosis, actually. So there's a lot of similarities between a outbreak of a drug-resistant form of tuberculosis that rampaged through this area where the Cecil Hotel is around the time of her death, actually. So this is very odd. Apparently, there's a field screening kit used by medics and EMTs that was used during this outbreak called the Lam-ELISA test, or enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay.
It's called LAM-ELISA, and it's spelled exactly the same way. Weird.
So this theory goes that, you know, tuberculosis probably didn't have anything to do with her death, but it's important to know that one of the drugs used to treat this disease is called, Isoniazid?
It looks like Isoniazid. I don't know.
But apparently this drug causes this weird abnormal behavior, mass confusion, you know, maybe even hallucinations. So there's not solid proof behind this at all, but it could just be a crazy coincidence that this was going on at the time.
Doesn't make a lot of sense.
No. But this one is the one that you were telling me about earlier, and that's the similarity between her death and the 2002 Japanese horror movie Dark Water.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in that movie, the girl dies falling into a water tank in a rundown apartment building while trying to retrieve her dropped bag. She dropped a bag in the water tank?
Yeah.
How does that accident happen?
And why?
Yeah, what? So that doesn't make sense either.
No.
She drowns in the water and the tank leaks into the building below, haunting it with her spirit. Oh my God, dude. What if you drank that water and like all the people who drank it are now like cursed or haunted or
Yeah.
Oh, that's so weird.
Oh God.
Ew. So fucking disgusting.
Oh God, yeah.
So that's what happened in the movie. The movie saw an American remake in 2005. I don't know who these people are. But the American version adds further weirdness to the coincidence because of the two characters' names. In the film, one of the characters named Delilah, Dahlia, like the Black Dahlia, and another is named Cecilia, similar to the name Cecilia Hotz.
That's odd, and that might just be coincidence, but that is bizarre.
Dahlia and Cecilia.
And these movies had scenes of malfunctioning elevator doors.
Hmm. Well, Dahlia and Cecilia were super popular names back then, though.
Yeah, so I'm saying that it's just coincidence.
Yeah,
but it is weird.
Yeah.
But this one is interesting too, and this theory is kind of out there, but it is interesting. Maybe she was playing the elevator game.
Yes, that's a big theory. That's because what everyone on the internet thinks.
People have studied and just scrutinized and picked apart the elevator footage, and I don't know how you could see this, but apparently the sequence of buttons that she pushes in the elevator seems to be 14, 10, 7, 4, B, and block hold button.
Well, okay, so there is some weirdness to that, I guess. The fact that this That's the order. But that is also, that makes sense. It's a row of three numbers. So 14, 10, 7, 4B block and hold would make sense. She just went down in a line.
Right.
So I don't know if that was like purposely planned, like she was like entering a code, or if she just happened to like, you know.
Right. Again, just coincidence, probably. But this is, you know, these are theories pulled from forums and web sleuths and, you know, people that really, really went all in on this case. And
yeah, this game's supposed to be a South Korean game. And I think the rules of the game, you have to be in an empty building, though. Like, you have to be the only one there. So I don't even know.
Yeah. But apparently, if you press the buttons a certain way or in a certain order and follow the set of rules, according to the game, you would be able to travel to different dimensions or something. That's really crazy and weird.
Huh. So maybe she was like seeing something. Maybe if there really is a paranormal element to this, when she was like looking, like doing this, maybe she was feeling something or.
Yeah. Or hallucinating. She could have even been hallucinating something.
Yeah. Maybe she had a plan to like take this weird drug and then try this weird game. I don't know. It seems weird.
Yeah, apparently there's some Bible correlation between some Bible verses based upon the numbers that she pushed. I don't know. I don't think there's too much to really talk about this. It seems
well,
let's
read them. It's interesting. I don't know a lot about the Bible, so I'm always interested to hear a verse.
So apparently with this Bible correlation theory, supposedly the numbers correspond to John chapter 4 and then verse 7, 10, and 14. And they read as follows according to the New King James Version Bible. So John
chapter 4 verse 7 says, "A woman from Samaria
came to draw water. Jesus said to her, 'Give me a drink,' for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. John chapter 4 verse 10 says, 'Jesus answered and said to her, If you knew the gift of God and who it says, and who it is who says to you, "Give me a drink," you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water.' John chapter 4 verse 14 says, 'But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life.'" I mean, I get the water like correlation. I think that's about all the correlation is, other than, I mean, I guess they're kind of saying like, maybe she's like, I don't know, maybe, I don't know. I really don't understand the correlation with this one, but it's a strange coincidence.
That seems like a huge stretch.
Yeah.
Was she even religious? Do we even know if she was like super religious?
No, I think this is just people literally like overanalyzing the numbers.
Yeah, totally.
And trying to find anything to connect it to.
If she had like, you know, scrouched down and clicked like, you know, random ones looked like it was a specific code she was trying to type, and I'd believe that. But it looks like she straight swiped a row of numbers, and that's how they line up. So I don't think the numbers have anything to do with it.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's just a weird coincidence. People love, when we talk about conspiracy theories, you know, there's theories that have legitimate evidence to them, and then there's just theories that people just make up. Yeah. And try to connect everything in order to come up with new theories to something. So that's what I think that is. Some other interesting things around this is that she was big on Tumblr, and apparently her Tumblr account continued to post pictures up to 6 months after she died.
Oh, that's weird.
And there was an update to her blog after her death as well.
Has that been confirmed by police?
Authorities.
What?
Yeah, authorities did say that they speculated this is just probably because she had set up her account to automatically post images for a given amount of time, which you can do.
Yeah, you can do that.
So it's not totally strange, but it is kind of eerie to consider.
Yeah, but I don't know if they. I don't know anything about Tumblr, so I guess I don't know.
So that is pretty much the theory surrounding this disappearance. Again, ultimately, the police ruled her death an accidental drowning, saying the bipolar disorder contributed to her behavior and death that night. Obviously, this did not suffice for her parents, David and Yina Lam. Her parents obviously would be upset about this, like any parents would, And they filed a wrongful death suit against the Cecil Hotel in September of 2013. And the hotel, of course, you know, wanted to have this dismissed because they had no reason to believe that anyone could get into the water tank. So why would they be responsible for her death if it was secured, there was alarms? You know, these tanks are really difficult to get into.
Yeah.
So why, you know, it, you know, in a normal situation, this wouldn't even be a question. Like, they shouldn't be responsible for that.
This is an interesting side note I'm reading on Wiki. She was initially assigned to a shared room on the fifth floor of the hotel, and her roommates complained to the hotel's lawyer would later describe it as certain odd behavior. And she was moved to a room after her on her own after 2 days. That's interesting.
Yeah, I mean, that's what really throws a wrench in it for me is like,
yeah,
she was exhibiting odd behavior before.
What kind of odd shit could you get into by yourself?
Yeah.
So weird. For enough for like people to be bothered by you in a room. They weren't like sharing a bedroom, right?
No, she had her own room.
Yeah. It was just like one of those conjoined rooms.
Yeah, a shared room. Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, what could she possibly have been doing over there? Oh my God. It reminds me of when we were in Australia and like there was like this couple like fighting. Whatever.
Oh, yeah.
I was about to complain about them. So I guess you could, but by yourself, that's weird.
So,
but I was trying to figure out what floor she was on because I was curious if she was on the same floor
that her room was on. She was on the fourth floor.
When she was doing the elevator thing?
Oh, when she was doing the elevator thing? I don't know.
So she was staying on the fourth floor. I was just wondering if she happened to be on the floor that she was staying on, or if she somehow got to that floor some other way. But I don't know.
Yeah,
it's probably
hard
to find.
I'll read you guys this real quick. This is interesting. This is the opinion of the coroner or medical examiner after the autopsy was complete. They concluded that the descendant died as a result of drowning. A complete autopsy examination showed no evidence of trauma, and toxicology studies did not show acute drug or alcohol intoxication. Descendant had a history of bipolar disorder for which she was prescribed medication. Toxicology studies were performed for the presence of these drugs. However, quantitation in the blood was not performed due to limited sample availability. Therefore, interpretation is limited. Police investigation did not show evidence of foul play. A full review of the circumstances of this case and appropriate consultation do not support intent to harm oneself. The manner of death is classified as an accident.
Why isn't there any other release footage of her? Like, there's so many damn cameras in a hotel. You'd think something else picked her up at some point that day. That's so weird. That makes it seem like they tampered with things. Oh, man. Because, like, wouldn't there have been footage of, like, her with someone else at some point if someone did, if there was foul play?
There should have been more evidence if it was foul play. They should have found more than they did.
But maybe they did. Maybe they did.
God, this one is just I get why it's like literally the, you know, most well-known.
I just realized there was a new show on this on IG Discovery. And remember, they featured me in it. I was like, tons of people sent me screenshots. I forgot I was in this.
So after looking at this comprehensively, was it a suicide? Was it murder? Or was it something more mysterious?
I was just trying to think of my final best guess. And I'm really torn between... The men's shorts are so weird. I think that's so weird. But maybe she was just wearing those kind of shorts too. Because actually, I used to wear those shorts. That's really weird. It wasn't 2002, but in high school, like my freshman year, 2007, 2008, I wore these Under Armour black boys shorts. It was kind of like in at my school, I remember. So it isn't that weird. They could have just been hers. And they did fit her pretty well.
Yeah, it wasn't like extra baggy looking, you know.
No,
like
kind
it
of
was
small
like
for
men.
A man.
And remember, she's 5'5", 120 pounds. So the shorts didn't look like those shorts looked fairly like fitted for her.
Yeah.
Unless it was like some small dude. But it's like they did test when they examined the body, they did do a rape kit. They did take all that stuff, and I don't think they found anything. I mean, there's conflicting reports online that say that there's evidence that she was raped and sexually assaulted, but I don't think that's true. I don't know. I didn't see anything that confirmed that. So if she wasn't sexually assaulted and then murdered, what happened to her? She could have had just a crazy psychotic episode, or like you said, I mean, maybe she had early signs of schizophrenia, or maybe she had a bad reaction to some sort of drug.
Mm-hmm. I think that there's a good chance of that, or it's some type of crazy drug that she was trying out in California. If she had this whole idea of live it up, test things, you know, don't live life on the sidelines.
That seems most likely. And I mean, you can't say that the police are like totally dumb and stupid. I mean, they obviously investigated they investigated this crime scene thoroughly. I mean,
this is interesting. Schizophrenia usually strikes first in young adults. Unlike virtually every other mental illness, schizophrenia is unique, and its first onset is always in young adulthood, not childhood or as a teen. Rarely ones after 30. So a lot of people, like, it's super, super common for people to develop schizophrenia in college.
And show symptoms in their early 20s. Wow, that's interesting. Yeah.
In college specifically, that's like actually a huge thing.
If she had these mental health conditions, I mean, it's very possible she may have had a schizophrenic episode where she was hallucinating, which would explain the odd behavior.
How did she get on the roof?
That's the question, though.
I don't know. We don't know, guys. We're going to leave this out. We don't fucking know. So what do you think?
This is insane, dude. What?
I know.
What? This is truly... I can't believe they're not still investigating this.
Yeah. No, they were done.
She got on the roof and... We saw those tanks. Like, how the hell did she do that?
But that's the problem, is it's the police job to figure out how someone died, but it's not always, they don't always take the time to figure out why. And if there's not
evidence of foul play, why would they go any further?
Yeah.
If there is literally zero evidence, I mean, they probably checked everything. And the fact that she was oddly behaving around her friends and stuff like that just raises...
And then the whole box, the men giving her the box really changes it up too, because it's not like she'd be getting a package. Like, how many people order delivery packages to their hotel? That's kind of odd.
Maybe it was a
package delivery person, a mail person, UPS, something. They probably would have said she was given a package by some UPS dudes, but it was just like two random dudes that they don't know who they are. So that's why it makes me think drugs.
It's possible.
So I think maybe she was suffering from schizophrenia. That's what the rest of the behavior was, or really bad bipolar disorder. And she took something else and had a complete psychotic episode. But then I can't explain why she got on the roof, how she got in the water tank, or how she opened the door to the roof. I don't know.
That doesn't make sense.
I don't know. There's no answers.
And what the hell with the elevator and stuff? That's weird.
I just will say, in cases like this, when you just are like, none of this makes sense. There's not one good, strong theory. And the police have just wrapped it up so quickly with sketchiness around it. There's likely some corruption going on. I will say that.
Sometimes, yeah, definitely. It's, I don't know. This one is just such a doozy for me. I have no idea.
It's a doozy. It's a real doozy. I have
no idea what to even think about it. Because, I mean, it...
No, I got it.
I mean, it could be... I mean, we can't completely rule out some sort of supernatural force either. I mean, that's the thing, is like... You know, if you remotely even believe in the fact that there could be some sort of evil forces at play here, it's possible, man. I mean, we don't know, so you can't rule it out. So who doesn't say that somehow she, I don't know, whether it's possessed or whatever you want to call it, but I don't know, man. It's really bizarre. I mean,
we want to know your theories. If you are a patron, you can get on the Discord and let us know what some of your theories are. If you have any questions about this case, you can ask it so we can cover it next time, because I'm sure you guys are filled with questions about this.
Yeah.
So, definitely check that out. That comes with the lowest patron level. So.
But yeah, I mean, I'm just going to say, I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know. But yeah, this was super interesting.
Clearly, we don't know.
Hopefully you guys enjoyed this episode.
Yes. Yes.
We enjoy talking about this. I find this stuff so fascinating. I mean,
yeah. Someone asked me today if you mind doing true crime.
No, deals. I. That's the thing, is like, I love true crime stuff.
Yeah.
Just probably just as much as you do.
Yeah.
you know, I just don't make videos about it, but
Josh almost got into law enforcement actually. So
yeah, no, I was very close to becoming a police officer and going down that road. So
when I met him, he was a sexy mini cop, as I used to say.
Was a junior.
Yeah. He had like the whole outfit though. And he would like go to events and like direct traffic and stuff.
Oh yeah. Well, I did like 13 or 15 police ride-alongs. I mean, I went to like a mini police academy.
Yeah.
I learned how to do investigations. You graduated I was top of my class too, by the way.
Oh, I know you are. I know you would be.
Yeah, so I have a natural interest. I actually have justice tattooed on my side of because at the time I was into criminal justice and all that. So
now it's just the day you
justice
got that.
For all. And
well, you know what? We are seeking justice. We are. Fits your tattoo finally fits. We've been waiting for years, and now it actually does fit you pretty well.
It does.
Seeking justice.
We'll leave you with that.
Yes.
Thank you guys for listening.
Yes, and so supportive. We seriously love doing this podcast. I hope you guys are digging it as much as we are, because we're so into it. We love like working on them and doing them, and the feedback. It's just such a fun thing and a completely new
platform
hobby
and just,
for me.
A whole new method of doing things. The podcast has been tons of fun. I love that we can just be casual and just talk about stuff.
Yes.
And so happy you guys are enjoying it. So
yes,
thanks again for watching and listening. Leave a review, rating if you enjoyed this episode. We'll see you next time. I'm at one, and I've been quiet for so long.